brought to you by Penguin.
The Nazis, A Warning from History, by Laurence Rees, read by Jonthan Keeble. If you gaze for long into an abyss, the abyss gazes also into you. Friedrich Nietzsche, Jenseits von Gut und Böse. Introduction. It's only by looking back that life takes on a pattern. That's as true of our own individual lives as it is of the great events of history. I never thought, for example, when I embarked on Nazis, A Warning from History in the early 1990s, that it would be the start of such a long journey. For it was only whilst making Warning from History that I fully realized the wealth of new historical material that the fall of the Berlin Wall had just made available in Eastern Europe. It was that, plus the growing realization that it was almost impossible to overemphasize the importance of the Hitler-Stalin War in any attempt to understand the mentality of the Nazis, that led me to move straight on to another project. I spent several more years writing, producing, and directing War of the Century, about the epic struggle between Nazism and communism. The pattern of all this work seems clear to me only now, in a way that it never was at the time, which is why I'm so grateful to BBC Books for reissuing here not just the original Nazis, A Warning from History, but for allowing me to incorporate within it the majority of the War of the Century book. For I think the material in War of the Century, particularly the chapter A Different Kind of War, vividly demonstrates the practical consequences of Nazism. Certainly, travelling around Russia, Belarus, and the Ukraine, and hearing stories about the Nazi occupation, allowed me personally to gain a greater insight into the essential nature of Hitler's worldview. A bleak landscape, where pity is outlawed and life is reduced to a Darwinian struggle, in which the weak deserve to suffer because it is their destiny. Of course, there are potential problems in slotting one book inside another. Some are easy to rectify, the danger of repetition, for example, and I've done my best to re-edit the text to avoid going over the same ground twice. I've also updated the content in places where my thinking has changed since writing the original words. That's particularly the case with the section on the origins of the Nazis' final solution. But there remains the real danger that, by focusing chiefly on the war in the East and hearing the extensive stories of Russian veterans, an impression is created that somehow the war in the West didn't matter. So I need to emphasize here that nothing could be further from my own belief. I grew up on the heroic stories of the sacrifice of British and American servicemen during World War II. My father flew in the RAF, and my uncle was torpedoed and killed whilst serving on the Atlantic convoys. It was because I wanted to see the full story of the Western Allies' fight against Nazism told to the widest possible audience that I devised television series such as Battle of the Atlantic and D-Day to Berlin, and then editorially oversaw their construction. But the book you are listening to is about something different. What I have tried to do here is to penetrate as deeply as I can the essential nature of Nazism. It's not a history of World War II, or an account of all the significant military decisions of the conflict, but an attempt to see how far it is possible to understand why the Germans and their allies did what they did. It is in pursuit of that aim, and that aim alone, that I thought it important to include the material from War of the Century. As I look back on this work now, I also see another aspect of it that I didn't fully recognize at the time. These books, and the television series that went with them, were based on approximately 100 unique interviews, many with former members of the Nazi Party. I had the chance to meet and question people who adored Hitler, worked for Himmler, fought on the Eastern Front, and committed atrocities whilst members of the SS. This is now an opportunity that is no longer available to anyone else who comes after me, for the simple reason that most of the people we interviewed have since died. In the heat of the production process, focused as I was on a forthcoming transmission or publication date, it didn't really occur to me that we were making something of value for future generations. Of course, as the number of survivors diminishes, attitudes to Nazism and World War II will also change. For my generation, the only way of understanding the world we grew up in was to know what happened during World War II. A divided Germany, the Cold War, the Soviet domination of Eastern Europe, the consequences of the conflict were all around us. But for today's schoolchildren, it is all very different. I remember the daughter of a friend asking me, when she was 7 years old, what came first, Adolf Hitler or the Battle of Hastings? To her generation, Nazism is just another bit of history, part of an enormous jigsaw that has to be fitted in along with the Romans, the Normans, and Henry VIII. You won't be surprised to hear, I guess, that I don't think that the Third Reich is just another bit of history. I believe that a study of Nazism still offers us a level of insight into the human condition that is different from the benefits of understanding some other periods of the past. To start with, obviously, the Nazis walked the earth not so very long ago. They came from a civilized country, at a time when, in the wake of World War I, a whole series of positive values and beliefs about democracy and human rights were prevalent in Europe. They smashed all that away, having gained power as a result of a series of elections that demonstrated that a majority of Germans, in voting for either the communists or the Nazis, had chosen to vote out democracy. Given that today there are so many fledgling democracies in the world, it's a stark warning. Then there's something even more significant that I think we ought to take from this history. I'd expected, when I embarked upon this task all these years ago, to meet countless former Nazis who would say, I only committed war crimes because I was acting under orders. However, when a former Nazi perpetrator was pressed on why he did what he did, his most likely response was, I thought it was the right thing to do at the time. It was a much more terrifying answer than the trite and self-serving one I'd been expecting. These former Nazis believed that their support of Hitler had essentially been a rational response to the situation around them. They told of how they had felt humiliated by the Versailles Treaty at the end of World War I, and then had to endure the revolutions and hyperinflation of the immediate post-war years, followed by the mass unemployment and bankruptcies of the early 1930s. They craved a strong man who would restore national pride and defeat the growing threat of communism. As the years went by, and I met more and more former Nazis, I came also to believe that there was another dimension to their support for the Third Reich that wasn't rational at all. Instead, it was emotional and based on faith. The quasi-religious dimension to Nazism is obvious, of course, and I discuss this at greater length in the first chapter of the book. But we also have to recognize that Hitler, as an individual, provided something for these Germans that other political leaders didn't. Hitler scarcely ever mentioned anything so dull as policies. Instead, he offered a leadership couched in visions and dreams. In doing so, he touched something deep within the human psyche. As George Orwell put it in his famous review of Hitler's Mein Kampf, human beings don't only want comfort, safety, short working hours, hygiene, birth control, and in general, common sense. They also, at least intermittently, want struggle and self-sacrifice, not to mention drums, flags, and loyalty parades. Many people also, Orwell might have added, like being told they are superior to others merely by virtue of their birth, and that recent catastrophic events in their country's history were nothing to do with them, but the result of some shady international conspiracy. I think in many ways I was naive about human motivation before I started on this project. I used to think that people made important decisions about their lives based on rational, intellectual criteria. Instead, the decision to follow Hitler and support him through bad times as well as good was to a large extent an emotional one, and we mustn't think of this as some kind of uniquely German trait. Look at your own life and ask yourself how many of the decisions you make in your life are actually rational. Was it a rational decision you made to buy the house or car you did? Do you like certain people and dislike others for rational reasons or emotional ones? And despite all of the work conducted over recent years by structuralist historians who seek to emphasize the circumstances that created Nazism, we still have to face the uncomfortable fact that Adolf Hitler was an extraordinary person who successfully played on the emotions of the German people. Of course, you already had to be predisposed to believe in what he was saying to be affected by him. Many testimonies contained in this book make that clear. And it needed an economic crisis over which he had no control to catapult him from obscurity to power. But the essential truth remains that for a number of people, even in the early years, meeting Hitler was a life-changing event.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.